Whether you are walking, running, digesting, sleeping, growing, or even thinking, you are spending energy. Almost all of the energy that your body uses to fuel activities is stored in a molecule called adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, which we've talked about before. To recap, ATPs are like tiny batteries that circulate in your body's cells, releasing energy when needed. In conjunction with this, your body synthesizes and recharges ATP molecules by burning fuel, mostly carbohydrates and fats. You eat not just to replenish your ATP stores, but also to create an energy reserve so you don't run out.
Measured over the short term, you are rarely in energy balance. When you eat and digest food, this will usually put you in a positive energy balance. And for the rest of the day and night, if you skip dinner, you will then be in a negative energy balance. But over longer periods, days, weeks, and months, provided you are neither losing nor gaining weight, it is because your energy balance is at a steady state. In simple terms, weight gain or weight loss is caused by extended periods of being in positive or negative energy balance, respectively. Because weeks or months of negative energy balance are bad for reproductive success, most organisms, including humans, are adapted to avoid this state.
One way to avoid being in negative energy balance is by regulating how much energy you expend. Your body spends energy on a variety of functions. A large component of your body's budget, your resting metabolism, goes towards taking care of essential needs, such as maintaining your brain, circulating blood, breathing, repairing tissues, and maintaining your immune system.
A typical adult's daily resting metabolism requires about 1300 to 1600 calories, but this cost varies widely, largely because of variations in fat-free body mass. More muscular bodies consume more energy at rest. The remainder of your energy budget is spent doing things like physical activity, digesting, and keeping your body temperature stable. So for example, if you lie in bed all day, you can maintain your energy balance by ingesting just a fraction more than your resting metabolic demands. But if you decide to run a marathon, you'll need an additional 2 to 3,000 calories. The other way we regulate energy balance is by eating. Food contains energy stored in the chemical bonds between its molecules. The basic components of food are the macronutrients, proteins, carbohydrates, and fats. Proteins are coiled chains of amino acids, carbohydrates are long chains of sugar molecules, while fats are made of three long molecules called fatty acids, held together by a single molecule of glycerol. The chemical term for fat is triglycerides. Protein is primarily used for building and maintaining tissues and is broken down for fuel relatively rarely. In contrast, carbohydrates and fats are stored and burned for energy, but in different ways. The key difference to remember is that carbohydrates are much easier and quicker to burn than fats, but they store energy less densely. A gram of sugar contains 4 calories of energy, but a gram of fat has 9 calories. This is why your body mainly relies on fat as a way to store energy in reserve. In comparison, it stores very little as carbohydrate, in the form of glycogen.
The different properties of fat and carbohydrates are reflected in how the body uses and stores them as fuel. The process begins the moment food enters your mouth, where enzymes in your saliva start to break down carbohydrates into their component sugars. And more enzymes continue that job further down in your stomach and intestines. There are many kinds of sugars, but the two most common basic forms are glucose and fructose. Glucose, which isn't very sweet, is the essential sugar that makes up starchy foods like cereal products and bread. This is quickly broken down to glucose. Carbohydrates like sucrose, which you'd find in certain fruits like bananas, and lactose, which you'd find in milk, are both made up of 50% glucose.
In any case, your intestines shuttles glucose into the bloodstream as quickly as possible because your body requires a steady, uninterrupted supply of it. But there's a catch. You always need sufficient glucose in your blood to prevent cells from dying, especially in your brain. But too much glucose is toxic to tissues throughout your body. Your brain and pancreas therefore constantly monitor and stabilize blood glucose levels by regulating levels of the hormone insulin. Insulin is produced by the pancreas and then pumped into the bloodstream whenever blood sugar levels go up, usually right after you digest food. Insulin has several other jobs, but its most critical function is to keep glucose levels from rising too high, which it does in several ways in different organs. One major site of insulin action is the liver, where about 20% of the glucose in your blood ends up. Normally, the liver converts this glucose into glycogen, but it can't store too much glycogen too quickly, so any excess is converted into fat, which either accumulates within the liver or gets dumped into the blood. The other 80% of glucose travels around your body and is taken up and then burned as fuel by cells in organs like the brain, muscles, and kidneys. The other most common kind of basic sugar is fructose, which tastes sweet. Fructose, which is often paired with glucose, is naturally present in fruit and honey, as well as table sugar, sucrose, which is 50% fructose. Unlike glucose, which can be metabolized by cells throughout the body, fructose is almost entirely metabolized by the liver. But the liver can only burn so much fructose at once, so, as with glucose, it converts any excess fructose into fat, which again is either stored in the liver or dumped into the bloodstream.
Fat's fate then is mostly determined by the liver. Some of it gets stored within the liver, some is immediately burned, and some is stored in muscles. But the remainder is transported by blood to specialized fat cells called adipocytes, which are found all over the body.
A typical human has tens of billions of these cells, each of which contains a single droplet of fat. As more fat is added to a cell, it swells like a balloon. Many of these cells are beneath your skin and thus termed subcutaneous fat. Some of these cells are in muscles and other organs, and some lie around the organs of your abdomen, where they are known as visceral fat.
The contrasts between subcutaneous and visceral fat are really important from a health perspective. Visceral fat cells behave differently from other fat cells, making excessive belly fat a much more serious risk factor than simply being overweight for many diseases associated with obesity. But I won't go into detail on that here. Now that we have reviewed the basics of how you store fats and carbohydrates as energy, what does that mean in the context of fueling your run?
From the moment you start running, your muscles and other tissues consume more energy. This results in a drop in your blood glucose levels, causing the secretion of several hormones whose job it is to release stored energy. One of those hormones, glucagon, is also produced by the pancreas, but has the reverse effect of insulin on the liver, causing it to transform both glycogen and fats into sugar. Another key hormone, cortisol, is produced by the adrenal glands, which sit atop the kidneys. Cortisol has many effects, but the main ones we're interested in here include blocking the action of insulin, stimulating muscle cells to burn glycogen, and causing fat and muscle cells to release triglycerides into the bloodstream.
Stepping back from the details, the bottom line is that your body functions like a fuel bank, storing energy after you eat food and withdrawing energy for using during times of need. This exchange, which is mediated by hormones, occurs through an endless flux of fat and carbohydrates to and from the liver, fat cells, muscles, and other organs. Humans have adapted over hundreds of thousands of years to be physically active, even during long periods of negative energy balance. Our ancestors would have frequently needed to hunt and gather on an empty stomach. Your body stores only a modest supply of glycogen, which you burn primarily when you need energy soon or fast. You store the vast majority of surplus energy as fat, which you burn slowly to get lots of sustained energy. So when you don't have enough food to keep your weight constant, in other words, to maintain energy balance, you can survive for weeks or months if you slowly burn your fat reserves and reduce activity levels. In fact, when glycogen levels in the liver fall too much, your body automatically switches to burning mostly fat, and if needed, some protein, to keep feeding your brain, which has no energy stores of its own. But over an intense period of activity, when you need energy quickly, your body will have a preference, focusing on carbs first and then fats.
Early experiments in the first half of the 20th century showed that the balance between fat and carbohydrate use depends on how hard you're working. During easy exercise, like a gentle walk, you burn mostly fat from the supplies circulating in your bloodstream. As you speed up, carbohydrates are used to an increasing extent. By the time you're breathing heavily, the proportions have flipped and you're burning mostly carbohydrate. The precise blend depends on a variety of factors. The fitter you are, for example, the greater the proportion of fat you burn at any given speed, simply because maintaining a given speed gets easier as you get fitter. No matter how fit you are, you'll burn the same fat-carb mix at any given relative intensity. Eating a diet high in either fat or carbohydrate also tilts your preferred fuel mix in that direction. But even taking these factors into account, carbohydrates dominate for any intense exercise. One study found that over the marathon distance, running at a 2-hour 45 pace relied on 97% carbohydrate fuel, while slowing down to 3 hours 45 minute pace reduced the carbohydrate reliance to 68%. As we've discussed, the sources of those carbohydrates mainly include your liver, which can store between 400 and 500 calories of glycogen for use throughout the body, and your leg muscles, which can store about 2,000 calories. That's why it's useful to eat a small breakfast a few hours before a morning marathon. Provided you have maintained your energy balance over the days leading up to the race, your glycogen stores in your muscles will be fully stocked, but your liver glycogen gets depleted because it fuels your energy-hungry brain while you sleep, so you need to top that back up right before your race. As you run, your muscles can also dip into the glucose circulating in your blood, though this is only a very small amount. The upshot is that a well-prepared athlete might be able to store 2,500 calories of carbohydrate. Running a marathon, though, for a runner weighing just under 70 kilos or 11 stone, takes around 3,000 calories, most of which will come from carbohydrate if you're racing as fast as you can. Harking back to the human body as a machine view we talked about before then, that means you either need to refuel your carbohydrate stores along the route or risk the well-known but dreaded phenomenon of hitting the wall.
Defining the wall is difficult from a physiological perspective. There is no single biomarker that reliably reflects the subjective experience of generalized fatigue, unintentionally slowing pace, desire to walk, and shifting focus to survival, which were reported by runners in a recently published survey. But in any case, in the avoidance of hitting the wall, it makes sense for endurance athletes to stock up on carbohydrates as much as possible. And that more or less is what sports scientists and sports nutritionists have been advocating since the 1970s. Keep your glycogen levels high by consuming a diet that gets 60 to 65% of its calories from carbohydrates. Top up your stores by carb loading in the final few days before a competition. And in events lasting longer than about 90 minutes, eat or drink some easily digested carbohydrates to supplement your stored glycogen, which will otherwise run out.
Empirically speaking, this advice seems to work quite well. One study found that Kenyan runners who currently hold 60 of the top 100 men's marathon times in history typically get 76.5% of their calories from carbohydrate, including 23% from ugali, a sticky and stomach-filling cornmeal mash, and 20% from the spoonfuls of sugar they heap into their tea and porridge. Another 35 times on the top 100 list are held by Ethiopians. A similar study found that they get 64.3% of their calories from carbohydrate, with the biggest contribution from injera, a sourdough flatbread made from a local grain called teff. This reliance on carbs is also reflected in the in-race nutrition plans of the elites. Haile Gebrselassie, when he set a world record of 2 hours 4 minutes and 26 seconds at the Berlin Marathon in 2007, drank about 2 litres of fluid during the race. Of these 2 litres, 1.25 litres was a sugar-sweetened sports drink and the rest was plain water. And he also took 5 sports gels, providing a total of between 60 and 80 grams of carbohydrate per hour. That number is significant because scientists have traditionally figured that 60 grams an hour, about 250 calories, is pretty much the maximum you can absorb during exercise. The rate-limiting step is the amount of carbohydrate absorption from the intestine into the bloodstream. But Gebrselassie was taking advantage of newly published data at the time, showing that if you combine 2 different types of carbohydrate, glucose and fructose, for example, they pass through the intestinal wall using 2 different cellular routes that can operate simultaneously, enabling you to absorb as much as 90 grams of carbohydrate per hour. Taking on that much carbohydrate in the middle of a race is not easy. You have to train your tummy to do it, but it does improve performance, based on a 2014 study which showed that runners who took on regular carbohydrate gels during a marathon ran nearly 5% faster overall than those they were paired with, based on ability, who did not. In theory, the math behind this sort of fueling plan is simple. The number of calories you need to ingest is the difference between how many you already have stored in your body and how many you want to burn. In practice, though, the body's workings turn out to be considerably more complicated. Researchers have recently shown that glycogen stores in your muscles don't just act as energy reservoirs, they also help individual muscle fibers contract efficiently.
That means your muscles will weaken as you burn through your glycogen stores, sapping your strength long before you're actually out of fuel, a kind of self-defense mechanism that's independent of the brain. Those muscles will also preferentially burn their stores of glycogen before turning to glucose from your bloodstream, the practical result of which, no matter how quickly you shuttle glucose into your bloodstream through energy gels or sports drinks, you won't be able to stave off fatigue indefinitely. In short, the limits of human performance in long-distance running events like the marathon cannot solely be attributed to fuel availability. As we've already discussed, fatigue is multifactorial. So too are the limits of human performance.